This video was made possible by CuriosityStream. Sign up for the Nebula Bundle deal for just $15 at curiositystream.com/realengineering to watch our Logistics of Close Air Support video that inspired this episode. Earlier this month, I posed this question to my Twitter followers. Was the P-47 Thunderbolt one of the best planes of World War II? And 35% of my audience said no. So in today's video, I'm going to explain why I disagree with 35% of my audience. As we will see over the course of this video, the P-47 had its flaws, but by the time the P-47D-25, easily identified by its distinctive bubble canopy, entered service in the spring of 1944, the P-47, in my opinion, was an excellent plane that was instrumental in the success of the Allied invasion of Europe. The P-47's reputation may have been a victim of its image. It's not sleek and aerodynamic looking like the Spitfire or P-51 Mustang, it lacks the stylish gullwing of the F-4U Corsair, and never gained the infamy of the Stuka. The plane is unusually thick. Seeing images of the crew standing next to their planes really demonstrates how huge the fuselage was. The crew of this P-47 clearly agreed. They painted the word chunky onto the engine cowl. But if you are like me, this should indicate to you that there is something unique about the plane, that the designers tried something different. The best way to illustrate this is through a size comparison. This is a P-51 Mustang. It's a streamlined, athletic-looking plane, and this is the P-47. You could have literally fit a P-51 inside the P-47 with room to spare. It simply doesn't look the part, but what if I told you, its frame was purpose-built to fit one incredibly powerful, supercharged engine. Just as its namesake, the A-10 Thunderbolt II, was built around its gun, its ancestor was built around its colossal engine, the massive Pratt & Whitney R2800 Double Wasp, a two-row, 18-cylinder, air-cooled radial engine with a massive displacement of 46 litres. The Merlin engine of the Spitfire and P-51 Mustang, for comparison, one of the most commonly used Allied engines of World War II, was 27 litres. And this was just the power plant. The P-47 was fitted with a supercharger that took up a significant volume of the aft fuselage, and this gave the P-47 some incredible high altitude performance. This shows the basic layout of the engine and supercharger inside the P-47 fuselage. The P-47 had a massive air intake just underneath the engine, big enough for a man to fit in. The air from this intake was not immediately funneled into the engine. Instead, it was routed to the back of the plane first, where it split into two ducts. One flowed into the supercharger impeller, which compressed the air and returned it to the engine carburetor, while the secondary duct flowed into an intercooler to cool the air from the compressor section, which had heated up as a result of the compression. Of course, this compressor section needed to be powered. This was done through hot, energized exhaust, which was collected from the engine through this collection ring, in a separate duct system. This air was funneled to a lower turbine section of the supercharger before the hot exhaust was vented to atmosphere here. At lower altitudes, less of this energized exhaust made it to the supercharger, as there are two gated exhaust nozzles on either side of the plane that gradually closed as the plane climbed in altitude. This ensured the R2800 Double Wasp was supplied with plenty of cold, compressed air even at 27,000 feet, where other planes could not funnel enough oxygen needed to achieve full engine power. And this wasn't the only trick the P-47 had up its sleeve. The P-47D-4 variants and onwards were fitted with a 30-gallon tank filled with an alcohol-water mixture located between the pilot and the engine in the firewall. In times of emergency, this mixture could be injected into the engine. This gave short bursts of additional horsepower, taking the engine from its already massive 2,000 horsepower to 2,300 horsepower. So how does spraying water into an engine increase horsepower? The water isn't fuel, and it displaces some air entering the engine, surely. Your immediate thought would be that this reduces horsepower. To boot, water is corrosive and incompressible, which could cause serious damage. Water injection increases horsepower in two ways, both as a result of water's cooling effects. When water is injected into the engine, it absorbs heat from the air and engine in the process of evaporating. This increases engine pressure and lowers the temperature of the piston. Colder air is denser, and thus more air-fuel mixture is carried into the piston with each stroke, increasing the energy released in each power stroke. The evaporation also cools hotspots in the engine that can cause pre-ignition of the air-fuel mixture, meaning the air-fuel mixture ignites before the piston is at the bottom of its compression stroke and thus is working against the power strokes in the other cylinders, lowering the power output of the engine. The limited water supply meant that this power boost was saved for emergency use only. But emergencies are the exact time a little boost in horsepower is needed, whether that is climbing a little faster to regain an altitude advantage after a diving attack, taking off with a little extra weight, or simply speeding away from an aggressor. With all these design features, the P-47 was a fast plane, with few planes being able to match its high altitude performance. Early versions of the P-47 did suffer from poor climb and turning performance. That massive engine added a great deal of weight, and by virtue of the large fuselage needed to hold it, a great deal of parasitic drag too. In order to climb or turn, the engine and wings need to provide the force necessary to lift the plane to higher altitude or shift its direction. These characteristics did not affect the P-47's roll rate, however, where it excelled thanks to fantastic aileron control. However, in a dogfight, being outturned or outclimbed was a death sentence. Climb rates were improved for the P-47D-22 and onward, with the addition of a new, larger propeller, a 4-meter diameter propeller nicknamed the paddle prop. It had a longer cord and distinctive cuffs which helped channel more air into the engine. This new prop made the climb rate disadvantage marginal, surprising German pilots who had become accustomed to pulling up sharply to evade P-47s. So, the P-47 wasn't the best out-and-out fighter. Surely the supercharger gave it excellent high-altitude performance, making it the perfect bomber escort. Yes and no, because of another design flaw. Its range was lackluster. The huge fuselage and engine made the P-47 a thirsty plane. Its fuel tanks were always going to struggle to feed this hungry engine. The plane could carry 305 gallons in two tanks located around the cockpit. The main L-shaped tank located in front of and below the pilot could hold 205 gallons, while the secondary tank located directly below the pilot could carry an additional 100 gallons. These tanks gave the pilot between an hour and a half and 2 hours of flight time, and only just 50 extra miles of range over the Spitfire, a notoriously short-range fighter. The Spitfire was primarily designed as an interceptor to protect British airspace. The P-47 was not designed for this purpose, and its lack of range frustrated bomber crews who relied on its protection. The pilots of the Luftwaffe were perfectly aware of the P-47's range issues and often waited for the pilots to turn for home before launching an attack. All but the earliest production runs of P-47s could carry a drop tank on the belly hardpoint, like this P-47D flying with a 75-gallon drop tank, which would have increased its range by 180 kilometers. However, plumbing, hardpoints, and wing reinforcements to allow for the wing-mounted drop tanks were added insultingly late with the P-47D-15. This allowed the P-47 to carry 108-gallon drop tanks on each wing, increasing the operational range by 380 kilometers, allowing P-47s to reach as far as Frankfurt and Hamburg. These tanks, of course, affect the plane's performance. Pushing weight outwards decreases the plane's roll rate significantly, but they could be jettisoned if needed during a dogfight. This was not an ideal solution, and the P-51 Mustang was, without a doubt, a better escort and fighter plane. However, the P-47 shined elsewhere. Those hardpoints were not exclusively designed to carry external fuel tanks. They were designed for weapons, and the P-47 could carry an impressive payload. the P-51 Mustang had a max payload of 450 kilograms across its two wing-mounted hardpoints and had six M2 machine guns with 1,840 rounds. The P-47, in comparison, could carry over twice the weight in bombs at 1,136 kilograms with four M2 heavy machine guns in each wing. The guns were staggered like this to allow side loading from each of their 350 round magazines. The P-47 was easily the heaviest hitting single engine fighter of World War II, and it could take a hit too. The plane was affectionately nicknamed the Jug, short for the Juggernaut, and for good reason. Durability is a difficult thing to quantify, and it's hard to parse out survivor bias, but just like the A-10, photos of surviving planes tell a story. If you were crash landing in any fighter in World War II, you would want it to be the P-47. There are countless photos of P-47 crash landings where the pilot lived to tell the tale. All that ducting around the pilot provided cushioning from the impact, and the smooth belly of the aircraft, free from air scoops and other protrusions, minimized the risk of turnovers, which could crush and kill the pilot, or simply trap them inside the plane. The P-47 could take a lot of damage and keep flying. The liquid-cooled Merlin engines of the P-51 Mustang were not known for their ability to take a hit, but the air-cooled R2800 Double Wasp radial engines were. The structure of the P-47 wings was incredibly durable and could stay intact with severe damage. The ducting for the supercharger provided some protection from bullets and did not cause catastrophic failure with a few bullet holes, resulting in a drop in supercharger pressure, which, at worst, required the pilot to drop in altitude and lower power. The fuel tanks under the pilot were self-sealing and offered good protection from hits on the belly of the plane, and the pilot had two armored plates behind and in front of the cockpit. So, we have listed the P-47's disadvantages, how they were minimized, and its advantages. What's my rationale for saying it was one of the best planes of World War II? People who learn their history from video games will bash the P-47 for its slight disadvantage in dogfighting, which is true enough, but it disregards the brain of the pilot. The P-47 had its disadvantages in a dogfight, but its advantages are what the pilots were trained to use, and they were trained well. Why engage in a dogfight when you have an altitude and speed advantage? The P-47 was the perfect hit-and-run fighter, striking from above, often catching the enemy unaware, and using its speed advantage to escape. They were most certainly capable of dispatching ME-109s and FW-190s, as proven by countless flight reports from pilots. ME-109s could most certainly outturn a single P-47, but outturning two or three was an insurmountable challenge, which was the challenge the Luftwaffe were met with as soon as the manufacturing prowess of the United States entered the European theater. The P-47 was like the M4 Sherman of the air, perhaps not the best vehicle on paper, but it got the job done and was there when you needed it. It was also the United States Air Force's best fighter bomber. This plane was the Warthog of World War II. With the Luftwaffe threat all but vanquished by D-Day, the P-47 truly shined in Normandy, becoming a feared bird of prey over Europe. The Allies quickly constructed advanced landing grounds in Normandy to create forward operating bases for their air forces, like Saint-Pierre-du-Mont, located just to the west of Omaha Beach. What was once a farmer's field became a fully operational airfield just 12 days after D-Day, with access roads, fuel dumps, ammo depots, and a 1,500 meter long track surfaced in steel square mesh track. These advanced landing grounds gave even the shortest range fighter aircraft the ability to loiter in the air over Normandy and push deeper into German territory than before. At this stage of the war, the Luftwaffe threat was all but eliminated. In this battlefield, the P-47 was in its prime. Saint-Pierre-du-Mont was home to the 344th Fighter Group flying P-47s, and they helped rack up the P-47's astonishing destruction record. From D-Day to VE Day, 360 days in total, the P-47 is credited with destroying 86,000 railway cars, 9,000 locomotives, 6,000 armored fighting vehicles, and 68,000 trucks. This plane played a vital role in the success of the Allied invasion, terrorizing German troops attempting to supply the front line with dive bombing attacks and strafing runs with its fearsome M2 heavy machine guns. Overall, the P-47 was a great all-round aircraft. Like the M4 Sherman, it was not perfect and had its weaknesses, but its weaknesses were a direct consequence of its strengths. The P-47 was a sturdy, reliable plane that kept their pilots alive, with plenty of firepower and tactical advantages to get the job done. A plane loved by its pilots and the ancestor of the iconic A-10 Thunderbolt, who doubled down on the P-47's strengths, creating a plane dedicated to the close air support role. The role of close air support played a vital part in the Allied invasion of Europe. The constant harassment German troops had to contend with while attempting to travel to Normandy delayed and blunted many of their counter-offensives. I made an entire video on the logistics of building the advanced airfields mentioned earlier, which is available now on Nebula. Nebula is a streaming platform I created with a collection of over 100 fellow educational YouTube creators. This platform has opened an entirely new avenue for creation for us, unshackling our creative process from the YouTube algorithm. The Logistics of D-Day series is written without tiptoeing around the realities of war. It's a series we can take our time producing. That time affords us the space to work on high-quality animations and ensure every episode is crammed with obscure and accurate detail on a side of war that is rarely documented. The lessons and skills we are learning while making this series has impacted the content we upload here, with the 3D animations of this video being a direct result of the new skill sets we developed with the time and funding afforded to us for this series. I am just one of many channels you will be supporting in this way by signing up. Wendover Productions, Mustard, and The Great War Channel each have their own fantastic originals. We have partnered with CuriosityStream to give you the insane bundle deal of CuriosityStream and Nebula access for just $19.99 a year. In fact, we are currently running a limited time 26% discount, so you can get both for just $14.79 a year if you sign up with the link in the description today. For that price, you will get access to all these fantastic originals from your favorite YouTubers and access to award-winning documentaries from some of the world's best filmmakers, like this hour-long documentary about the weird and astonishing miracle machines that came out of Nazi Germany in the final years of the war. As always, thanks for watching and thank you to all my Patreon supporters. If you'd like to see more from me, the links to my Twitter, Instagram, Discord server, and subreddit are below.